must have mire and water. Job chapter 8 verse 11. Can the rush grow up without mire? Can the flood grow without water? The rush and flood referred to in this scripture are two different kinds of plants. While mire is an area of wet, soggy, muddy ground. The rush needs mire for its growth, and the flood cannot grow without water. Now, speaking of those who have been redeemed by the Lord, Isaiah chapter 61 verse 3 says that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. We want to look at four of the things that could be classified as mire and water, which we, the planting of the Lord, need for our growth. These are simple things that we know but need to be reminded of every now and again. The Word of God is part of that mire and water. No Christian should be satisfied with just listening to sermons on Sundays. We have to also attend Sunday school, Bible studies, and other programs in church where we have an opportunity to listen to the Word that gives us not only life, but life as well. Psalm 119 verse 105. We also need to study the scriptures on our own so that we can receive more revelations from the Holy Spirit. Satan wants us to be completely dry, so he gives us several reasons why we cannot put any time into studying the scriptures. The body is tired, you need to sleep, you just have to watch your favorite TV programs. You can study tomorrow if you are not able to do so today. And then, the interesting thing is that Satan waits for you tomorrow to ensure also that you do not study the scriptures. We all have to understand that there will never come a time when the devil, the flesh, or the world would encourage or even easily allow us to study the scriptures. Matthew 11:12 says that the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and that the violent take it by force. Let us not apply this scripture to only when we need to violently recover lost financial comfort or health. It also applies to redeeming our time from the hands of the enemy so we can use it to develop ourselves spiritually. In addition to studying the Bible directly, we should also cultivate the habit of reading good Christian literature and listening to teaching tapes produced by true children of God. The emphasis here is on true, because according to 1 John 4:1, many false prophets are gone out into the world. Again, we are told in 2 Peter 2:1 that there shall be false teachers among us. We cannot afford to read or listen to just anything that people have to offer, because the devil and his agents are making very desperate moves to cause as many believers as possible to stumble and fall. That is one of the reasons why we should guard our hearts with all diligence, according to Proverbs 4:23. Guarding our hearts involves, among other things, making sure that nothing that conflicts with the Word of God enters into it. The Holy Spirit is the mire and water we want to look at next. When Jesus was on earth, he said that without him we could do nothing, John 15:5. When he went back to heaven, the Father sent us his Spirit to take the place of Jesus. Who else could do the great work that the Holy Spirit is doing in the lives of believers today? He gives us understanding of the scriptures, the power to please God, the right counsel when we do not know what step to take. He gives us comfort and encouragement when we are weary and feel like giving up, and so on. In John chapter 20 verse 22, Jesus breathed on his disciples and said to them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." And then in Ephesians 5:18, we are admonished to be filled with the Spirit, which is even several steps above just receiving him. Your spiritual growth cannot be stunted when you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Another type of mire and water we want to consider here is fellowship with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. 1 John chapter 1, verse 3. Remaining in constant fellowship with the Trinity keeps spiritual dryness away. Note that fellowshipping with the Father is not just about having our quiet time in the morning and praying before we go to bed at night. It involves being generally lost in his presence all day and all night, even when you are asleep, and letting nothing else matter to you. It involves not taking your eyes and ears off him, even when you are in the midst of others. God is on your mind at all times. You meditate on his word, his nature, and so on. You are in constant touch with heaven. In Habakkuk 2:1, the prophet said, "I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower, and will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved." Now, you cannot have your eyes, ears, mind, and so on tuned to the Lord and be struggling at the same time to know the people that are gossiping about you and what they are saying in your extended family, neighborhood, office, or even your church. You care less about such, and so all you are exposing yourself to are words that help you to grow in him. Also, the more you spend time in the presence of God, the more you hate to get out of it, and so the more efforts you will put into pleasing him because you don't want him to push you out as a result of you being sinful. Finally, other godly people are part of the mirror and water that we need to grow. There is no one that is such a spiritual giant that he or she does not need other believers. It is even spiritual pride that will make a person think that he can do without others. Iron is needed to sharpen iron. Also, the Bible says, woe to him that is alone when he falls, Ecclesiastes 4:10. Falling is not just about backsliding. There are times when you come across a situation where you need other believers to join you so that together you can resist and push the enemy off, Ecclesiastes 4:12. Let us learn from the experience of the people of Laish in Judges chapter 18. When destroyers visited them, there was nobody to deliver them. And verse 28 says it was because they were far from others and they had no business with anybody. We all need one another. Remember Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. The assembling together of believers is not only about church service. You can cultivate healthy, godly relationships with other Christians. That scripture says we need to exhort one another, especially as the coming of the Lord draws nearer. Sticking together with fellow believers has a way of helping you to keep your eyes on the Master, living for him and serving him. Here again, we have to note that there is a need to be careful. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 verse 21, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. There are many false brethren, just as there are false prophets and teachers, and anyone who associates too closely with them can get distracted and miss heaven. But then a man who closes his eyes because he does not want to see when evil people are passing by will also not see when good people come along. We cannot isolate ourselves totally from everyone just because there are false brethren. If we do that, we will miss the water and mire that God is sending to us by way of sincere brethren. The Holy Spirit knows everything and everyone. And as you allow him to guide you in every choice you make, he will surely not lead you into close relationships with people that could make you fall. Let him choose your friends. Think of other things that represent mire and water which we need for our spiritual growth. As the body of Christ and as individual Christians, God wants us to keep growing and maturing until we come unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, Ephesians 4:13. Make good use of all the mire and water that God has provided to make this happen. May the Lord help us in Jesus' name.